It's always the lie that is loudest. I know the one with the power. It's never the one who is shouting, shouting. I lean in, I know that I need to listen. Through all of the thunder you whisper, even in doubt you are with me, with me. Like a love song that I've always known, your word hits me deep inside my soul. When you speak, I'm found in the sound of peace, be still. The wind and the waves bow to your will. You drown my fear with a love more real than anything, anything I feel. When you speak, when you speak, I know you're not the God of confusion. Why do I feel like I'm losing my mind every time? I can't see what you're doing. Like a love song that I've always known, your word hits me deep inside my soul. When you speak, I'm found in the sound of peace, be still. Redemption's frequency, healing me, healing me. It's the Father whispering mercy over every need, breaking through and breaking free. Healing me, it's healing me. When you speak, when you speak, when you speak,
sometimes heartache is the gift I need. You're faithful, faithful in all things. In every high, in every low, mountain tops, down broken roads, you're still my rock, my hope remains. I rest in the arms of Jesus, come what may.
I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. The Lord is my shepherd, leads me to still waters, and He restores my soul. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Oh, the Lord is my shepherd, leads me to still waters.
Returning to the secret place, just an altar and a flame. Love is found here in our sacred space. I hear your voice, I see your face. You're still my first. Just for you and me, break the bread and pour the wine. Perfect union, nothing in between. I am yours and you are mine. You're still my first love. You're still being honest, I didn't think you'd stay with all my problems. I was so afraid that when you saw them, you would turn your back on me and leave. 'Cause in the silence, my insecurities are like a siren taking over me.
Good morning and welcome to Bendigo Baptist Church. It is so great to be together, and what a wonderful privilege it is to be able to worship in person and online and just be able to magnify the wonderful name of Jesus. I just want to read a scripture to you this morning. It comes from Joshua chapter 1 verse 9. It says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Some of us need to know that this morning, that God is with you wherever you go. That actually can be quite a scary thing, because sometimes you want to go without God. You want to leave him at home. In fact, sometimes at church we want to leave him at home because you don't want him standing next to you when you're singing. This morning, we're going to stand together. We're going to sing. We're going to worship. And God's standing right next to you. Sing loud. Praise. Take some time to just let go of all the things that are sitting at home waiting for you. Let go of the fact that you might be a bad singer. Some of you are like, uh-oh, she's talking to me. And just praise anyway. The person next to you can't hear you. Maybe they've turned their hearing aid off. Maybe they just don't care because they're worshiping too. Let's worship the name of God together this morning. He is with us. He wants to hear our praise. Let's lift up the name of our mighty God together. Let's stand and sing.
Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water and come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness and find what you're looking for. The world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there. God so loved the world that he gave us his one. just as holy. Jesus, he's so worthy of it all. He exists in everlasting light, so on heaven's streets there is no
God. And as we stand here today, some of us bring some baggage with us. And we need to know that God goes before us with that. And he says, lay it down. Stop carrying that. Because I will carry your burdens. That's what I'm here for. I want a relationship with you, and I'll help you through that. I am faithful. I will prove my faithfulness to you. And I know that personally because God has never, ever let me down. I don't always get yeses, but his promises have always been faithful to me. I want you to know that. As we sing this song, I want you to think about all God has done for you. Maybe you don't know him. Maybe this is a first-time experience for you. But I want you to think about your life and think about what is this all about as you sing this song.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. And I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. And my heart will sing your praises again. Jesus, you're still enough. And keep me within your love. And my heart will sing your praise again. Still stands, and great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
Never will forget.
risen King, Lamb of God, holy and righteous, blessed Redeemer, bright morning star. All the heavens shout your praise. All creation bows to worship you. How wonderful, how beautiful, living above every name, exalted high. How wonderful, how beautiful, Jesus, your
Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. And I will sing forever. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you.
Let's just hold this moment right here in prayer. Father, you know our hearts this morning as we gather here in this room or we watch online. You know how we've woken up this morning or what our week has been like. And maybe for some of us, we come with heavy hearts, but we're here. Father, this morning, this time of worship, this time of singing has given us an opportunity this morning to remind us of what's truly most important. And so we gather to honor you and to lift high the name of Jesus, the name that is above all other names, who is worthy of all of our praise. Jesus, we just acknowledge before you this morning, we are so grateful for all that you have done for us. We thank you that your perfect sacrifice on the cross has restored us back into relationship with our Heavenly Father. We thank you this morning for the gift of your Holy Spirit that lives within us, that walks with us, that we aren't left as orphans. So we worship you this morning. Father, thank you. Thank you for the gift of your Son and for the gift of your Spirit. We thank you for what you're doing in this place this morning as we gather together in worship. Father, we pray that your Spirit, like this wind that we feel just in here right now, here in this moment, we pray that your Spirit would just blow afresh in and through our lives. We know that it's not about us. We gather together to worship you. But Father, we pray that in this moment, in this time together, we would have a sense of what you are endeavoring to do in and through us. So we worship you today. We gather together to bring glory and honor to the name of Jesus. We thank you. We love you and we adore you. And we pray all of that this morning in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior. And everyone said, amen. Hey, it's good to be together. Can I encourage those of you that are in this room, don't sit down. Go and say hello to someone. For those that are online, hey, chat with our online host, Judy, this morning over the next minute or so. Wonderful to be together this morning. It's like family, isn't it? One of the things I love about family gathering together is that often the house is just filled with noise. I don't know about your family, but I can find myself sometimes just sitting on the couch. And I may not even be participating in what's going on, but there's a smile on my face as I watch my children and my grandchildren and everybody. There's just noise and laughter, and sometimes there's anger in there as well too. But it's in the midst of all of that that it's just good to be together. I just want to welcome you this morning to those that are online for the very first time this summer. It's great to have you. My name's Dave. I'm a part of the ministry team here, and for those that are in this room as well too, just wonderful to be together, and I'm thrilled to see you. I'm looking out and I'm seeing faces that I don't know. It's welcome to Bendigo Baptist Church, and I trust that today is a wonderful morning for you. If this is your very first time here or online today, that this is a moment where you just sense the Spirit of God doing a great work in your life today. That moment may have already happened for you and you're already full, and maybe it's still yet to come. Whatever that might look like, yeah, every time we turn up with an expectation that God's going to do something powerful in our midst as we gather together as family. And so good to be together this morning. Hey, Good to see families here with their kids. We love having everybody here in church. That's a great thing. Our children's ministry programs are just a couple of weeks away, so first Sunday in Feb. But if you're here with young kids this morning and it all gets a bit much for you, the Red Room is available out there. You're welcome to head out there, or you're welcome to just stay in here as well too. You know, the day as a pastor, the day I don't hear children is the day that I probably will mourn. Because I think that's indicative of in church life. When there's no children around, that's a sign of, you know what, that church is in trouble. So I give thanks to God for all of our generations here in this morning service, and it's great to be together. Hey, a couple of things that I just want to share with you today. First, that our summer series has been brilliant. I'm getting such wonderful feedback from people saying how blessed they are to be hearing the different speakers that are happening across all of our services, Eagle Hawk, Juniton in the morning, Juniton at night. And we love our summers because it gives us an opportunity to encourage the wider body, to give people an opportunity to step up, to explore the gifts that God's given to them. And so I have sure today there's going to be just another day of that for us as well too. If you are... I want to be back out again tonight. One of our council members, a young fellow by the name of Spencer McWilliam, who I've had the privilege of seeing grow up, he is going to be preaching tonight. So if you're just sitting around tonight watching tennis, well, that's not a good enough excuse. Our service is at 5 o'clock tonight. There's a dinner afterwards as well too. Come on out and bless our PM congregation too. So just a bit going on there. Hey, do you realize we're only a few weeks away from Easter? Hard to believe, isn't it? Someone was asking me this morning, how's the year shaping? I said, it's really great. We've planned all of our sermon calendar right through this year, and within a month we'll be looking at 2025. Person looked at me and said, that's crazy. I said, yeah, it is a little crazy, but you know, we like to kind of get some things planned and kind of going as we launch into the year. But with Easter just being away, just a few weeks away, that gives us a wonderful opportunity. And we did it last year. It was Way of the Cross, an opportunity for us to kind of stamp ourselves front and center of all that kind of goes on in the Easter season. Let's have a look at this video, and then I got a little bit of a call to action for you, okay? Turn your attention to the screens. Way of the Cross 2024. Now, here's the call to action. Last year, we had a great number of people from churches right across the city involved in the Way of the Cross. It was great to see it back there in Rosie Park, and a great gathering on that particular night. And you know, that just kind of puts us into the midst of all that's kind of going on across that Easter season. But here's the call to action. We need people to be a part of that production. We need people with all kinds of gifts and skills in all of that. And so if you would like to possibly consider being part of that, and it's not just the older generation, it's the younger ones as well too. You know what? The interesting thing is those disciples probably weren't 50 and 60-year-old men. Funny that, isn't it? They were most likely in their they were young adults. And so I'd like to think that we continue to keep growing a younger generation into all that as well too, but it's not limited to anybody. If you'd like to be a part of it, you either see Julie, my wife, straight after this service, or go to the website right now, Way of the Cross Bendigo. The QR code's gone off the screens there, and you can just register or... what's it called? Expression of interest, something like that. And it's an audition form. There you go. So, there's your call to action. Love to think that there's going to be more people from our church, campuses, and our congregations involved in it this year. Hey, I want to spend just a couple of minutes before I welcome Tam, our guest speaker, up this morning, and looking forward to what she's going to share from God's Word today. You know, there are a number of things that we value at Bendigo Baptist Church. values and beliefs. And I think one of those things would be the core convictions that we stand upon as a church that we've stood upon for 170 years. You know, often we might refer that as our kind of our doctrine, or you know, it's really our values, our beliefs, the things that we hold dear. It's the things that we don't waver upon, that we would drive a stake into the ground, that we would stand strong upon. And that's shaped who we are for 170 years, and we'll continue to keep defining who we are in that sense. But we've got another value that sits out there that runs pretty strong through all of us. And I'll name it. I won't put anybody under pressure this morning. But that value that we hold as a church family that sits here not only in this campus but at our Eagle Hawk campus and our soon-to-be city campus as well is our value for being disciples of Jesus that make other disciples of Jesus Christ. So I'm very clear in my mind that when Jesus left, he didn't just kind of leave it up to the church to do whatever they wanted. His mission was really clear. He told those 12 young men to therefore go and make disciples of all the nations. And he not only kind of gave them a mission, but he also gave them, they'd spent 3 years together, so they knew exactly what to be doing with all of that. And so for us as a church, we are strongly committed to that value of being and making disciples of Jesus Christ. So when we gather together as a family in this room, that kind of permeates all that we do. When we think about our ministries that are going on, that just flows down into all those things as well too. You see, that value of being and making disciples, I would say, is both an individual value, because I'm strongly committed to being a disciple that makes disciples. And I know our church council and our staff team, they hold that value very strongly. But not just being disciples, making disciples, we hold that individually. But I want to say that as a church, it's the culture, the thing that we're going after is that collectively, that is a value that we want to continue to keep holding here in the life of this church. So it doesn't matter whether you're brand new on the journey as a follower of Jesus. We've got people here in this room and online that fall into that category. Or whether you've been following Jesus for 70, 80, 90 years, is that as a church family, that is a value that we're not going to let go. And so as a ministry team, we're always thinking through and asking ourselves the question, you know, how are we doing with this culture? How do we keep improving this? Where are the gaps? How do we keep building culture? Culture is really important, isn't it? You know, all of our families have culture. Every family, you could identify the culture of your family. Well, here at Bendigo Baptist, we want to have a culture as well too. And part of that is being and making disciples of Jesus. And so, if you've been around long enough, you've heard me talk about this a lot. And we'll continue to keep talking about this in the coming weeks as well. But how does that impact what we do? Well, I want to say that it impacts everything that we do. You know, individually, we choose certain habits, or we take on choices because we're committed to being disciples of Jesus. And so there are certain habits, practices that we would have individually that help foster all of that. But then when we gather together collectively like this as a large family, those things are still going on. So as we shape a sermon series, as we think about ministry and we gather together in larger groups, we're always thinking about how do we shape a culture of being and making disciples. Well, we have a whole bunch of ministry programs that do that, and we don't just run programs. Can I just tell you, we don't just think of things that maybe we can do because we've got nothing else to do here at Bendigo Baps, but we're always thinking about this. And this is where the rub comes for you guys, for us to be thinking about as a church family as well too. Just this past week, as we were gathering together with our team, I became aware that in some of our ministry areas that we hold up really strong, they're really important to us because they help us be and make disciples in some of our younger ages, but in our children's ministry, in kids biz, but even more so in our primary school age in Gateway. Do you know in our Gateway ministry for this year, could be, I don't want to give actual numbers, well, I'm going to give you some numbers and they may be a little bit off, but you know what, out of our team from last year, we've only got 4 people that are coming back to help out in our Gateway ministry this year. I look across this room and I think, oh wow, that shouldn't be an issue for us at all, because people everywhere should be putting up their hands and saying, you know, how can we be a part of this culture that we just are so passionate about being and making disciples. our youth church that goes out when the sermon starts and they head out for 30 minutes. We had a team there, but we've only got about two people there that can do, help in that, and that's only on a here-by-here basis. We want to be shaping across all of our ministry areas a culture of being disciples that make disciples, and it doesn't matter where we're at in the journey. You see, if you're only new to the faith and been following Jesus for a couple of months, you've still got something you can add into all of that. Or maybe you're older and you've been on the journey for a little bit longer. Do you know what? We need everybody putting their shoulder to the wheel around making this a church that's striving after and achieving its culture, its God-given culture, a biblical culture. Here at Bendigo Baptist, we're committed to the vision of being an empowered community who are reaching our city, state, nation, and globe for Jesus. You know, there are certain things that we celebrate in all of that because it's the narrative, it's the story of us going after that culture. But how do we do it? We make disciples that make disciples. We do that best in, we make biblical disciples in relational environments. Hence why we hold up our life groups as such an important mechanism, a vehicle for people to get into. You know, ideally, if you were to ask me, I would say that everybody that sits here in this room right now would be part of a disciple-making group. Because when that becomes the culture, that just continues to keep bleeding out everywhere. So I'm saying that to you this morning to, can I ask you to be prayerfully thinking about where you might be involved? If you're not already heavily involved or not involved, for those that are already doing heaps, you know, you just keep praying. They've got to keep raising up people because the, you know, harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. But if you are here this morning, or if you're even local here and you're watching online today, for you to be prayerfully thinking about, how can I be a part of what Bendigo Baptist Church is doing? You know what? Our community care, it's strongly resourced. Lots and lots of people that are a part of that. Where are our summer gaps? Where are some of our gaps? It's on the grounds and what happens in our weekends and throughout the weeks. So as you think about that and pray about that, I'd love to have you think that you're going to be talking to some of our staff team. Donna, who heads up our children's ministry. Matt Park, Matt Johnston, who's across our youth. Young adults, come and talk to Michael Curtis, who is here at nighttime as our youth minister, our young adults ministry worker. A number of different ways in which you might get involved, and that's just the tip of the iceberg, okay? Here's the other thing. I want to just, you know, maybe this is the chance for me to say it right now. You know, we have to own this. And so we can own that with our gifts or even exploring our gifts. But we also have to own it with our finances too. And this just presents us with an opportunity to say that as we think about what we're going to give and bring in 2024, it's a chance for us to be praying through. Father, is what I'm giving right now, is that what you're asking me to give? Or if you're not bringing anything, it's an opportunity for you to think about, well, what can I contribute financially to God's work in this place? You know, I've said it before, you know, it's not equal giving, but it is equal sacrifice. Some of us can give more, but we can all give something. And so I'm asking us as we kind of launch into this year to be thinking through all of those things. I'm super excited about this year. I've got a great set. Last year was good. A theme of whatever it takes. And that's a theme for being and making disciples of Jesus Christ. A couple of weeks' time, we're going to speak to our new ministry theme that's centered around our disciple-making culture that we're going to keep kind of carrying into this year as well too. But above all things, we're just going to keep praying. Praying and trusting God that He's going to lead us and He's going to use us to reach people not only this city, but this state and this nation and globe for Jesus. So would you maybe join with me? I want to pray right now. And then I'm going to introduce Tam to you after I've done that. So let's pray together. Father, your word says that unless you build the house, the laborers build in vain. And we don't want to be a church where we labor in vain. We don't want to turn up and just go through the motions. We don't want to just do church or play church. We want to be the church. And Father, I pray that you would stir all of our hearts to be thinking about what's that look like for us individually and collectively as a church family. That how we can put our shoulder to the wheels and pull together in the same direction around that value of being and making disciples. Father, I have a sense that in this year that your word says that you are doing a new thing. You spoke that over the Israelites, and Lord, there's a sense that that principle is still timeless, that each and every day in all of our lives, you are doing a new thing. So Lord, I pray that for Bendigo Baptist Church and its different iterations. Thank you for our campus locations, for our city campus, and the space of getting going. Father, thank you for the people that are involved in ministry. We're so blessed. But Lord, you've called us all to the task to not just be consumers or people who come and watch, but to play our part in being and making disciples. Father, would you do that for us? Lord, as we gather together, I'm conscious that we've got a team in Indonesia today. I pray for them as they wake to this day that wherever they might gather together as the church, there'll be a profound and a wonderful experience in their lives, that they'd be a blessing into the lives of those that they're with. And would you keep shaping in those individuals that have gone? Lord, keep doing your work in their hearts and lives as well too. Father, I think of those that are gathering today that are hurting and are struggling and just need a touch of your spirit today. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would minister deeply into them. Lord, as we give, God, take our finances and would you bless us with an abundance of resources that we can continue with what we need to be doing. Grant leadership and volunteers and ministry leaders, Lord, grant them wisdom. Lord, keep them safe. Protect them, I pray, as we lead, as we look to you. Lord, keep our hearts closely connected to you. And Lord, keep speaking to us. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, we stand on the authority of your words. It is our final authority in all things in life, and so we hold that up high. And so, Father, as we open your word this morning, would you speak deeply and richly to us? We thank you for Tam. We thank you for her ministry with her family here in this space. We pray that you would bless her and that you would speak through her right now as she comes. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, would you join me in welcoming Tamaryn Lim as she comes to the platform this morning? I'm going to just take an opportunity just to introduce her just really briefly. Some of you will know Tam. She's often anchoring services here in the morning. She is sometimes online as an online host. She is all things passionate about The Chosen, and that has had a wonderful ministry to a whole bunch of people. Tam and her husband, Yen. Yen was on the keys here this morning, have been with us for about a decade.
Just over a decade.
I remember when they first turned up here, having come from the UK at that point in time. Tam's from the UK, so you'll hear that in her accent this morning. Yen is from Malaysia. They both met in the UK and then have got three beautiful children that have all been born in different continents around the globe. But we have been so blessed by their ministry as a couple. And Tam, we look forward to what you're going to share with us this morning. Let's put our hands together again.
Well, thank you, Dave, for that kind introduction and for your warm welcome. It's so lovely to be here with you all. If you've been tracking with this summer sermon series, you'll know we've had some wonderful speakers over the last couple of weeks, and I feel so privileged to sort of follow in their footsteps and be here with you today. So thank you for having me. Let's dig into God's word together. I want to start this morning by asking you all a quick question, just with a show of hands. Who here has a hobby or a passion that you make time for? It could be a sport, a musical instrument, you might craft something with your hands, perhaps you like traveling, could just be something as simple as doing the crossword every day. Yep, that's what I thought. Thank you, you can pop your hands down now. For those of you online, most of the room had their hands up at that point. And most of us do have something, don't we? We may or may not be skilled at it, but we all have things that we enjoy and we look forward to doing. We try to make time for them amongst the busyness of our work and family lives, and we aim to do them regularly and try to improve our skills or learn more as we go along. I've tried my hand at quite a few things over the years, tennis, baking, singing. Soon after we got married, my husband, Yen, who, as Dave said, was on the keys this morning, he tried to teach me the piano. And we very quickly decided that for the sake of our relationship, that wasn't going to be a very good idea. So I still can't play the piano, but he does, and I think he does a great job. The one thing that has been a constant hobby for me, though, is reading. I'm a bit of an introvert, and I love nothing more than finding a quiet corner and curling up with a good book. When I was little, that meant something by Roald Dahl or Enid Blyton. I moved up through to Anne of Green Gables and the Little House on the Prairie series, and then found myself in the classics by Jane Austen and the Bronte sisters. Whatever spare time I had, my nose was usually in a book. I loved reading, and I still do. Several years ago, however, I began to be convicted by the Holy Spirit that I didn't treat reading my Bible in the same way that I did reading a novel. I didn't particularly look forward to it. I was careless about making time for it. It just wasn't a priority for me. I knew in my head that I should be reading scripture, but my heart was slow to catch on. I would much rather have been reading a novel than something which I felt at the time was dry and dull, or maybe hard to understand, or that I'd just read so many times before. Now, please don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that my hobby was necessarily a bad thing. But I had allowed it to take a higher priority in my life than it was meant to occupy. I put it above spending time with God. I valued my alone time with my books more highly than I did my time in His Word. Peter tells us in his first letter that we are supposed to crave the pure spiritual milk of God's Word in the same way that a newborn craves its mother's milk. And I'm sure most of us have seen just how passionately and instinctively a baby will demand to be fed. Well, I'm sad to say that my attitude towards reading the Bible was nothing like that. But God is gracious, and over time, He's helped me to make some changes which have totally transformed the way that I approach His Word, and thereby had a significant impact on the depth of my relationship with Him and on my faith. So today, I want to share a little of that journey with you in the hopes that you too can grow deeper in a knowledge and a love for God's Word, and that the Bible will become your favorite book as it has become mine. We'll look together at exactly what God's Word is, why it's important, and some practical tips about how to engage with it and how to develop a passion for it. So let me pray for us before we get started. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your word, and thank you for the message that you have laid on my heart this morning. Lord, it is an immense privilege to partner with you. May the words I speak and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you today. Would you grant us ears to hear and minds to understand all that you want to say to us? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, what exactly is the Word of God? Well, before we look at that question, maybe we should look at what we mean by the word, word. What is a word? Well, the dictionary defines it as a single, distinct, meaningful element of speech or writing, used with others or sometimes alone to form a sentence, a way to express thoughts and feelings or communicate information. We use words every day to communicate with each other. Now, some of us might use more words than others, but we all rely on words to make our thoughts, desires, and feelings known. Our words also reveal a lot about who we are as we use them. So if we apply this definition to the Word of God, we can see that in its purest form, it's simply God communicating with us and revealing Himself to us. In the beginning, God communicated directly. Adam and Eve walked with God in the Garden of Eden, and they were in a face-to-face relationship with Him. But then sin entered the world and broke the channels of communication. And that meant that we were left to discern His will and purposes for our lives through other, less direct means. Over time, God gradually revealed Himself through His chosen people, through the gift of His law, through the visions and dreams of His prophets, to form what we now know as the Old Testament. But sin was still a problem, separating us from God. No one was able to lead a sinless life. And so God, in His great mercy, did something incredible. 400 years after the last prophet spoke to God's people in the Old Testament, God broke his silence with the cry of a newborn baby. He began to reveal himself and communicate with his people in a very new and highly personal way. Jesus was everything God wanted to say to the world in a person. He came to reveal the heart of the Father for his children and to take our sin upon himself. He bore the punishment that we deserve for our sin, putting it to death on the cross and giving us his righteousness in order that we might be restored to a full relationship with God. All that Jesus said and did whilst he was here on earth is preserved for us in the New Testament. And together with the Old Testament, these scriptures form what we now call the Holy Bible. It's this that we most often think about when we refer to the Word of God. It's the main way that God speaks to us today. 66 different books by 40 different authors, written over a period of 1,500 years in three different languages and on three different continents, but that tells one complete story. A cohesive revelation from God, about God, for the benefit of his people and the glory of his name. Now we know from the first chapter of John's Gospel, as well as from the resurrected Jesus himself when he spoke with the disciples on the road to Emmaus, that all of Scripture is breathed through him, points to him, and is about him. The Bible is not simply a book to be read, but the Word of God himself, alive and active, to be engaged with and learned from. If we look carefully, Jesus can be found in every part of the Bible. Both testaments are essential to fully understand who Jesus is, because God uses both to tell his story. So understanding this helps us to learn enough of God and from God to believe in him, to acknowledge that we are sinners in need of salvation, and to accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And so hopefully we come to faith. And that's great news. It's wonderful. It's the first step in restoring our relationship with God. I wonder why it is then that for so many of us, once we have come into that saving relationship with Christ, that we stop pursuing him and we stop looking to know him more. Our Bible reading becomes sporadic or a duty rather than a pleasure. Something we approach without the expectation of learning anything new or of having any fresh revelation. Our passion for God is lost and other things take priority in our lives. When God made me aware that this was happening to me, I began to search the scriptures for help. And God revealed to me four important reasons to be prioritizing his word, as well as a key that has transformed the way I approach my Bible reading and is unlocking new truths and hidden treasures in both the Old and the New Testaments. It has caused a deep yearning within me to draw closer to Jesus, to spend time in his word, and in turn, that is bringing transformation and renewal to all areas of my life. So let's take some time now to look at these areas together, and these reasons together, sorry, before moving on to some practical things that we can do to make the most of our time in God's Word. The first reason for prioritizing God's Word that I want to highlight, and by the way, these are in no particular order of importance or significance, is found in Psalm 119, verse 105, where King David says, "Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path." King David goes on to describe the word of God as a lamp carried on his journey to distinguish the way and keep him from stumbling off course and going astray. The word translated lamp in this passage is ner, N-E-R, in the original Hebrew. It refers to a small clay lantern with a solitary wick, something portable like a torch, not the kind of lamp that you might have in your living room at home that sort of sits in one corner and stays in one place and just lights up one particular area. Just as we use a torch to brighten a path for our feet to walk on a dark night, so God's word provides the illumination and the guidance we need to walk our journey in this world. It's God's wisdom for the decisions we need to make around how to pray, who to trust, what to do in any given situation. It also lights up the areas of our lives that might be in shadow, so that as it says in Ephesians chapter 5, we can walk as children of light and discern what is pleasing to the Lord. And just as a Nair or a torch is portable, so we need to carry the Word of God with us. And by that, I mean we need to apply the Word of God to all areas of our life, not just those areas that we feel most comfortable lighting up. God wants access to all areas of our life, the good, the bad, and the ugly, because His light is a healing light. It exposes our sins, yes, but in so doing, it saves and delivers us from the hold that darkness has on us. Also, as Pastor Dave pointed out a few weeks ago, the evidence is increasingly pointing to the fact that we are approaching end times. We need to view what is happening in our world through a biblical lens. And the only way to do that is to study the Bible, to saturate ourselves in the Word of God so that we are equipped and prepared for the future. Trying to navigate the world without the Word of God is like stumbling around in the dark. It's scary and it's dangerous. And for those of us with such easy access to God's Word, it's also completely unnecessary. So a second reason for prioritizing our time in God's Word, is because it nourishes us. In Deuteronomy 8, verse 3, Moses tells the Israelites that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Just as we need physical bread to nourish our physical bodies, we need spiritual bread to nourish our souls. Too many of us are literally starving to death from a lack of time in God's Word. Or worse, trying to satiate our hunger with spiritual sweets and lollies, the things of this world which look appealing, but have no substance and are not healthy for us. So drugs, excess alcohol, promiscuity, overspending in the shops, all these things are an attempt to satisfy that deep soul hunger that God alone can fill. Jesus said in John 6, verse 35, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. We need to be spending regular time with Jesus in his word to fill our spiritual stomachs with good things. And it's worth remembering that even when we read God's word and it doesn't seem to have a special meaning for us, it's still nourishing us. It's not likely that this time next year you'll remember what you had for breakfast this morning, unless you've had something amazing, but I mean, for me, it was just Weetabix. But that breakfast has still filled you up and given you the energy and the nutrition that you need to get through today. Now, we may remember some meals and savor them over and over again for years. And in the same way, sometimes we'll have an encounter with God in His Word that gives us goosebumps and is really significant for us. But much of the time, what we read isn't groundbreaking. It doesn't mean to say that it's any less important. A third reason to be prioritizing God's word is because it is a weapon. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 6 that we are all involved in spiritual warfare against the kingdom of darkness, and that we need to take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The word Paul uses for sword is the Greek word makaira. Now, makaira was a short, straight, double-edged blade that a Roman soldier would use in close combat. It was extremely sharp, used both defensively and offensively, and soldiers would have been fully trained in its use and required to practice with it every single day to maintain their skills. In the same way, we need to train and practice in order to take up and wield our spiritual swords effectively. Owning a Bible or having it downloaded on your phone is not enough. But every time we memorize a verse or learn where to find it in the Bible, we are adding a sword to our arsenal. Every time we learn something new about a verse, we're sharpening the blades. And every time we learn how to apply a new verse, we become quicker and more deadly in the use of that sword. In John 16, 13 to 15, Jesus tells us that the Holy Spirit will help us to do this, to understand and retain the passages that we study, and to remember and recall them when needed. We have a responsibility to learn the word, and then the Spirit will help us to use it correctly in the right situations and in the right ways. Friends, whether we know it or not, we are all engaging in spiritual battles every single day. We need to be able to defend ourselves from the kingdom of darkness and to prune or cut away those things in our life which are not healthy. It's not for no reason that we may be struggling with our Bible reading. Satan does not want us engaging with the truth of God's word. He knows that he cannot stop the word of God from bearing fruit in our lives, and so he tries to stop it from taking root. He will use distraction, busyness, boredom, anything he can to stop us from reading our Bibles, so that he doesn't have to deal with the consequences of us growing in our faith and living fruitful lives. Our best defense against his attacks is to take up the sword of the Spirit by spending regular time in God's word and allowing it to take deep root in our lives. The fourth and final reason that I want to share with you today is based on Romans 15, verses 4 and 13. Paul writes, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Hope is an incredibly powerful antidote for the problems we face in the world currently. Aaron Beck, the founder of cognitive behavioral therapy, found that a sense of hopelessness is a key driver of depression and suicide. Conversely, having a sense of hope contributes to a better physical and mental health. In a study by the Center of Bible Management in the US, it was shown that when the Bible is read regularly, and by that I mean at least four times a week, loneliness decreases by 30%, anger by 32%, bitterness by 43%, alcoholism by 47%, and the use of pornography is reduced by 60%. How amazing are those statistics? Reading our Bibles regularly opens a conduit through which the Holy Spirit can pour his encouragement, his joy, his peace, so that we can live hopeful, not hopeless lives. If we fail to afford the Spirit this opportunity, we are only doing ourselves a disservice. So there we have it, four important reasons to be reading our Bibles: for wisdom and guidance, for nourishment, for our protection, and to overflow with hope. Knowing these things in our minds, however, is not always enough to change our habits and our behaviors. To do that, there needs to be a shift towards heart knowledge. So how do we do that? What's the key when, as humans, we are so easily distracted and ready to give up when things get hard? Well, I believe that the answer is the Holy Spirit. As we've already seen, the presence, power, and passion of the Holy Spirit brings the Word alive, illuminating the Scriptures and helping us to apply them to our circumstances. The Spirit of God also helps us to obey the Word of God. But I hear you asking me, Tamaryn, how do we access the power of the Holy Spirit? Well, the key for me, and I think for all of us, is prayer. To quote Charles Spurgeon, prayer is the slender nerve that moves the muscle of omnipotence. When we pray alongside our time in God's word, it's like rubbing two sticks together to create a fire. One stick on its own is not enough, but two together grant us full access to the power of God, causing our hearts to burn within us and giving us a fiery desire to draw closer to Jesus. The more time we spend with God, both in his word and in prayer, the more he reveals himself and the greater the hunger he gives us to know him more. You see, spiritual hunger works in the opposite way to physical hunger. With physical hunger, we wait until we're hungry and then we eat. But with spiritual hunger, we need to start eating to feel hungry. And when that happens, when we have that hunger, we quite naturally begin to prioritize our time with God's word, because we're enjoying it and we're learning and we're growing and we're seeing the fruits of our time with him. It's been my experience that with the direction and guidance of the Holy Spirit, even those long lists of names in the Bible can come to life on the page. Do you believe me? Let me give you an example. If you turn to Genesis chapter 5, you'll see an account of Adam's family line from Adam to Noah. Now, on the surface, it seems just like a simple list of names and ages and birthdays. So you've got Adam, Seth, Enosh, Kenan, Mahalalel, Jared, Enoch, Methuselah, Lamech, and Noah. But if you dig a little deeper, you will find a jaw-dropping summary of God's plan of redemption hidden in the genealogy. If you take the meaning of each name in order and put it together, it reads, "Man appointed mortal sorrow. The blessed God shall come down teaching. His death shall bring the despairing rest." How incredible is that? Little did those people know when they were naming their children that God was spelling out his plan of redemption to anyone who would take the time to notice. How good is our God? And there are many, many, many more interpretations, connections, and fulfillments of prophecy just waiting to be discovered as you dig deeper. The wonderfully exciting thing is that as we grow in our knowledge and love for God's word, it grows with us. Whereas when I was younger, I had to find new books to tempt my growing mind, when we read the word of God, the book doesn't change, but our insight does. As Cardinal Raniero Cantalamessa said, scripture reveals new meanings according to the questions people have in their hearts as they read it. There will always be more to learn because God will continue to communicate and reveal himself to us when we are actively seeking him and in relationship with him. So thinking practically, what are some things that we can do to discover or rediscover a passion for God's word? Well, it helped me to approach it in the same way that I would have tried to pick up any other hobby. The first thing we do is to find something that interests you. This is your way in. For me, as a lover of words and their meanings, God has guided me on a path to learning some basic Hebrew and Greek. Languages fascinate me, and unfortunately, whilst it's a blessing to be able to read the word of God in my native tongue, much meaning has been lost in the translation to English. I love the poetry and the meaning behind the Hebrew and Greek words, and I found the study of them to be something that draws me closer to God and deeper in love with his word. Now, I'm not saying you all have to do the same. Your way in might be different to mine. Perhaps you have a favorite book or character. You might begin by studying that in more depth and see where it takes you. Or you might find a particular passage that speaks to you and choose to commit it to memory. If you're a visual learner, I can highly recommend watching The Chosen. Watching that for me, seeing the stories and the characters that I was familiar with reading brought to life, gave me a hunger to go and find out more about them and got me back reading my Bible more than I had before. Whatever it might be, I highly recommend praying and asking God to show you what will work for you. That is a prayer he will delight in answering. Secondly, learn from someone with experience. When we pick up a hobby, we might start watching training videos on YouTube or find a skilled teacher willing to share their knowledge and their passion. The same goes for when we're learning to go deeper in God's word. It's helpful to read the Bible alongside a devotional or a study guide that can help to explain the context of what you're reading. And as Kathy said a couple of weeks ago, don't discount the benefit of reading alongside a mentor or a friend. Share what you have read and what you think God is saying to you with someone else. Talking it through gives you fresh insights and viewpoints, which can be extremely helpful. Third, choose a time and place that works for you and practice. Commit to spending regular time in God's word, even when you don't feel like it, even when it gets hard. Don't give up. Ask God to help you, but don't feel guilty if some days don't go as planned and you don't get to reading your Bible. Just recommit to starting back the next day. God does not condemn us, but he is faithful to keep calling us back to himself because he loves us and he wants to bless us. And lastly, enjoy the rewards and the fruits of your labor. My life has been positively impacted in every area since making my time in God's word a priority. And so many exciting opportunities, including this chance to share with you all today, have come about as a result. I feel like I am growing in my faith. I'm more willing to share my faith with others. And most importantly, I feel closer to God than I ever was before. Because as he reminds us in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 17, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. As the worship team come back up on the stage, I wonder how God is speaking to your heart this morning and what your response to him will be. For some of you, you may never have read the Bible and have yet to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Can I encourage you now, if you are feeling that tug on your heart to learn some more about who God is and how much he loves you and why he wants a relationship with you, there is no better place to start than by spending time with him in his word. If you don't know where to start or have questions, please come and find me after the service. We'll also have our prayer team here at the front who would love to have that conversation with you. If, like I was, you've been following God for a while, but you know in your heart that you are not pursuing him with all your mind, with all your strength, if you have allowed other things to take precedence in your life, let today be the day that you recommit to regular time in God's word and in prayer. Make God your number one priority, and then watch to see how everything else in your life falls into place. You may need to fast from other activities to make time, but I guarantee your efforts will be rewarded. And for those of you who are regular readers of God's word, I hope today has been an encouragement to you. Know that God sees you and that he hears you. Keep it up. Keep learning. Keep growing. Keep listening to God and looking for his revelation. It's my prayer that all of us will fall deeper in love with God and draw closer to him as we spend time in his word. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you for gifting each one of us with abilities, talents, and passions. We ask that you would help us to use them for your glory, but that they would not take priority over our relationship with you. Lord, we want to put you first in all areas. Please draw us close today through time in your word and in prayer. You are all we want and all we need. We love you, Lord. Amen.
help me find the way and bring me back to you.
Come here this morning expecting me to share something about my favorite Bible verse or character, and hopefully I'll get the opportunity to do that one day. But I hope you've seen how the Bible can become your favorite book. It's certainly my favorite book, and it's my prayer for you that there will be no more distractions, that the Word of God will become your number one priority. And I am so looking forward to hearing the stories that will eventuate as a result of all of us spending more time in the Word of God. If you would like someone to pray with you this morning, our prayer team will be here at the bottom of the cross. Judy is also online for those of you online if you'd like someone to talk with. If you're new here, if you have any questions, please head out to the Connect desk. You can also email us, connect@bendigobaptist.org.au. Otherwise, please stay for a cup of tea and fellowship together, and go in peace. Have a wonderful week. God bless you all. Thank you. So
King, seated on the throne.